Good morning. Welcome. It's Coffee with the Cops. It is, of course, the community coffee here at the Hobbs Police Department on a beautiful Wednesday morning. And Captain Walker is stepping in for Chief McCall this morning. Good morning, sir.
How are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for being willing to kind of take a little bit of the charge this morning. We always are grateful for an opportunity to come and have coffee and donuts with the Hobbs Police Department, as well as a lot of great neighbors and friends and folks who are here to talk about various issues, things going on in their world, things going on in your world, and we're going to invite them to do that. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for New Mexico Junior College and the City of Hobbs partnering together to bring the roundtable to you each and every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And if you are tuning in now, you may be getting it on the website, you may be getting it on YouTube or Facebook, or you may be tuning into Channel 19. All of those are great options as to how you can take part in our roundtable program. Captain Walker, a little bit about today's special guest. Next Tuesday is a big day, and so I, in conversing with you and Josie about what we should do today, we got a lot of people who are going to be able to share some thoughts with us today about that.
We did. We got several candidates from local races for the general election that's coming up Tuesday.
Excellent. Now, Tuesday, November 4th is the day. That, of course, is this coming Tuesday, next Tuesday, however you look at it, the next one upon us. I usually get on a soapbox, and I'm not going to do it today because we do have so many people to talk to, but my soapbox usually is, it is our right. It is something that we have been given an opportunity to help direct our course of our country and of our cities and of our states. And so you got to take advantage of that opportunity on Election Day.
That's right. I'm the same way. You have to get out and vote. And luckily now we have the early voting, so
absolutely,
I'm going to take advantage of that today.
And it's been going on for several weeks. It will continue to go on through, I believe, Monday. And actually, I think they even consider early voting on Tuesday, if you look at it in that way. But the actual day, Tuesday, is when everyone will go to the polls if you haven't already done the early voting. I do know that we've got the Lea County Clerk here to talk a little bit about where you can go between now and then and how you can get there. So we've got a big day planned, and we appreciate you, Captain Walker, for helping to set this up for us.
Yeah. We love having everyone here and encourage people to come down.
Thank you so very much. And as he said, the doors will be open. We'll be here for another hour or so, as we are every Wednesday. You're welcome to come between 7 and 9 Wednesday mornings and between 8 and 8:45 if you'd like to get on camera. How about Judge Willie Henry? We'll come and have a seat next. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. And we'll start this off, and I forgot my cheat sheet. I see that somebody brought some over there. I should grab one between now and, you know, the rest of the show. Judge Henry, no, sir, you can walk me through it. Nice to see you, sir. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Now, one of the reasons why you're here is because you are one of the few contested races of this upcoming election. Tell me what you currently are, what title you hold, and what the race is that you will be fighting for next Tuesday.
I'm the magistrate judge here, the presiding judge here at Hobbs, and I'm currently been here 4 years now.
Okay.
And I'm excited.
Tell me a little bit about wrapping up this first opportunity. This is the first time that you've done a judgeship, correct?
This is my first.
Okay, and so 4 years, you've got some experience under your belt.
Yes.
What is it that you found most exciting about this time?
Most exciting is working with the people. Mm-hmm. And as a bailiff when I was at the district court,
right,
for 9 years, I learned to work with people, do the things I need to do to make sure everything's running right in the courtroom. There's a lot of stuff that goes on between that time, and now I have a way of getting stuff done.
Right.
And I feel that with this experience now, like I say, with knowing people that are coming in and out, same over and over stuff, then we can make the right decision upon doing the best we can.
And 4 years, we talk a lot when we talk about elections about experience, and obviously I think experience comes in various ways. You've got experience in that courtroom. What are some of the things that you think that is going to be as a benefit to you if you were elected for another four?
For another 4 years being elected, I feel as this would be that knowing what to do in cases and so on. I mean, there's certain things that we look at upon each case that comes about. Each
right.
case is different. And whatever it is, my concern is a lot of things of a DWI driving that comes through the court, what penalties to impose on the person that's been convicted of a certain thing. And as a judge, you have to look at those things to make sure that everything is running a right way.
Right. And part of that, I would imagine, is you mentioned being familiar with the people, but being familiar with the process and being familiar with the consistency of what's already been done and what could be done.
Yes, exactly, because it's the consistency of people coming back to the same,
right.
same cases that they're being charged with,
right.
And everything. Those are things you look at and making sure that it's done properly.
Do you have any aspirations of what may be after this? Let's say that this 4 years goes the way you're hoping come Tuesday. What's the future like, or are you only focused on the next four?
I'm looking at the next 2 or 3 more years.
Yep, okay.
Terms, that is.
Right.
When I got in this position, I made a decision to run for not just 1 year or 2 years or three. I want to continually do what I'm doing to protect the people, help the people, and do what's right.
You'd like to finish out whatever you have to contribute in this form?
This is exactly.
I love
contribute
that.
It because I feel that with my experience upon knowing what's going on, I can be an aspect to the people here in Lea County.
Just to give people a little additional information, tell them about yourself when you're not in the role of judge here in Hobbs.
Well, I'm also I'm a official.
Okay.
I'm a father. I'm a grandfather, and official in basketball. I've always been around the community with kids, refereeing summer league basketball. A lot of people see me there every night. And you see me there and blowing a whistle over and over.
Right.
I feel that this is something that keeps me busy. And like I tell everyone, I got 2 jobs as a judge because I make decisions on the court.
Right.
A basketball court and in the courtroom also.
In the courtroom.
And it just so happened that people ask me, okay, there's a winner and there's a loser. And all I do is make a decision to make what's right. And we go from there.
And do what's right. And that's really it. Last couple of comments. What would you like to say to the voting audience about what you'd like them to do this coming Tuesday?
I just like for everyone to get out and vote. Oh. And if you're not voting for me, vote. But my thing is that I feel I've been out in the streets talking to people every day, and I'm hoping that would work for in my benefit, and I believe it will, because the people I've talked to has guaranteed they're going to vote,
right.
And I'm looking forward for that vote, and I feel that we're going to have a victory in this race, and I'm looking forward to it.
Well, good luck to you, Judge. Appreciate you taking the time this morning to come and visit with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your time.
We'll hopefully talk to you soon on or off one of the courts. I'd rather be on the basketball court with you than in the other court.
Well, I want to be on this court, too.
Okay.
Just come and talk to me.
Okay, just come in to chat. That sounds good. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
All right, we're going to shift gears, and if Ms. Lima White would come up, and we'll get her in the comfy seat here. As you've noticed, we are talking with candidates for the upcoming general election happening next Tuesday, November 4th. Good morning, Ms. White. How are you?
Good morning.
Good to see you. I'm going to move this down just a little bit. Welcome to the roundtable and welcome to this race. Tell me a little bit about yourself, what you're currently doing, and why it is that you've decided to run for magistrate judge.
Well, I was magistrate judge for 4 years from 2006 to 2010, and then I lost the race in 2010, and I'm retired. I'm a retired educator. I taught school in Hobbs 35 years and a year in Texas, making 36 years total.
It's a lot of educating.
Yeah, exactly. I did a lot of educating. And then I just was on a lot of committees and different things, and I just decided one day that maybe I should do something other than this. I was appointed to the first seat in Lovington. I was judge in Lovington.
Okay.
The governor appointed me to that seat, and I stayed there 6 months. And then I decided, well, come home and run for the judge in Hobbs.
Okay.
And I did, and I won, and I enjoyed every day that I was there.
What did you enjoy most about it? What was the aspects of being judge here in Hobbs that appealed to you the most?
Well, what appealed to me was trying to help first-time offenders to understand this is your first time, you made a mistake, it can be, you can help yourself if you want to. And working with the general public, working with the police department, all appealed very much to me.
It was definitely a different side of things than what you had been dealing with the rest of
yes,
your career.
Exactly.
Yeah. New opportunities. And what did you find was the biggest challenges that being a judge and that maybe you overcame or that maybe you'd like another opportunity to even get better at than what you were in those 4 years?
The biggest challenge was repeat offenders, mm-hmm. people coming back over and over, and trying to get them to understand that they needed to look outside of themselves in order to try to break that chain of coming back to the courts so often. That's one of the biggest challenges. Second biggest challenges are trying to get people to understand what the court system is all about.
Yeah, because it's an intricate process.
Yes, it is.
And what you think makes sense, unfortunately, doesn't necessarily mean what's in the law books.
Exactly.
Right. And being knowledgeable about all of that, I'm sure, is a huge help, but it takes time. So in that 4 years, I'm imagining that you were able to really get inundated with what the laws were.
Exactly. And they train you. They take, when you become, win the election and become judge, they train you. You go to the Office of the Administrative Courts, and they take you through a whole training system to learn the processes of becoming a judge. They don't leave you just hanging out there.
They don't just say, okay, go do it.
No, they train you, and then you have to go at least once a year to judges' conference and to get all of the latest information that's been put out there. For instance, when the legislature convenes and they make new laws, then in the fall of the year we go and they teach you all about those new laws.
You get it right, you get it fresh.
You get it fresh.
I see.
And you come back and you implement those laws.
Well, it sounds like quite a process.
It is, and the magistrate is the people's court.
Right.
And so every magistrate judge should be there to give information to the public, to help the public, because the public really doesn't understand the processes of the court system,
right.
The legal system, and we should always be there to give out the information and to help in whichever way we...
To educate them.
Yes,
educate
possibly
them.
Can.
What are you doing in your spare time when you're not running for the magistrate judge position?
Well, I'm retired, so I can do anything I want to do.
You're doing all kinds of good things.
I do all kinds of good things. You know, I mean, I travel sometimes, and I have some great-grandchildren that I see after. My grandchildren are grown.
Right.
So I have great-grandchildren that sometimes we interact with each other, but I do just about anything that I feel like doing, and I work with the church sometimes, with my church sometimes.
Excellent. And tell our audience why it is that you would like to be elected as the magistrate judge for this next four-year term.
Well, I feel like that there were some things that I wanted to accomplish that I did not get an opportunity in the 4 years that I was there before to accomplish, and that going back would give me that opportunity to finish up that work.
Excellent. Well, we wish you the very best of luck.
Thank you.
Ms. Lima White, thank you so much for being here. And we are going to talk a lot more with a lot more folks, but we are going to go ahead and take a quick break. We're going to get ready for the second half of the show, which is going to entail lots of other candidates, both those who have an opposing person that they will be campaigning against and hopefully in their minds winning on Tuesday, and some who are just here because they want to talk to you about how important an election is this coming Tuesday, November 4th. Don't go anywhere, friends. We'll be back right after this.
Are you working? What about your education? New Mexico Junior College has classes for you.
Hi, my name is Daniel Marquez, and I have a great job. I also have my degree from New Mexico Junior College. I worked full-time in the oil field and still finished my degree in 2 years. I took dual credit courses at Lovington High School and then day and night classes on campus. Come on, make New Mexico Junior College your school too.
And we're back, of course, Coffee with the Cops on this Wednesday morning. We are talking about all things election, because the general election for the state of New Mexico, as well as many other big races and some local races, are happening all on Tuesday, November 4th, which is next Tuesday. Early voting has begun. You can go and vote, I believe, today all the way through Saturday, and then maybe again on Monday. We'll let Pat tell us a little bit more about that in a few minutes. I want to slip to a different realm for just a few minutes, because we have other great guests who have joined us this morning, specifically the soccer coach for the USW, the men's soccer coach. Welcome to the show, sir.
Well, thank you.
And what was your name, since I didn't know it?
My name is Robert Sejemba.
Okay, Robert, it's a pleasure. You are actually a new coach here?
I am, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Excellent. Yes. Tell me how long you have been in Hobbs, America.
Well, I moved to Hobbs in June, actually.
Okay, so you've got a few months under your belt.
Yes, a few months, yeah, definitely. Yes.
What do you think about not only our fine city, I am biased, sir, but also the University of the Southwest and your new soccer program?
Oh, man, well, this is a whole, you know, new place for me. I moved from the west, from the East Coast. So,
okay, where at?
In Bristol, Virginia.
Oh, Bristol, great racetrack.
There's more green there, I guess.
Yes, definitely more grass, more trees.
Exactly, but, you know, Southwest, I love it. You know, there's a lot of good people there, and that was one of the reasons I was really attracted to this place.
Well, we appreciate that, and I have to agree with you. I think we got great people.
Yeah.
Tell me about your new program, because the men's soccer program at USW has been around for several years.
Yes, yes.
But you being the new coach, what were some of the first observations that you were able to make about this program?
Well, first of all, the program, I was impressed by the quality of the players that I inherited, and last year the program had some success. They played in the Final Four in the conference.
Excellent.
So that was a good start.
Right.
So I'm really just excited about the future with the players we have, and obviously the plans for the future. Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about what those plans are. What is it that you foresee happening with this season, now that you've gotten to know your athletes a little bit better?
You know, this season we've been, you know, we are very young, and actually we have two games left. We didn't make the playoffs, but I think, you know, we have such a bright future. We have a lot of young players. Our team is half and half.
Okay.
Half, you know, about 15 returning players and 15 freshmen. I think the experience that we, you know, had throughout this season is going to be really very, very important moving forward. So just a general a picture of the program, where I see it. I see us competing for championships. I see us graduating players, and also impacting our community. So that's kind of the overall picture of an athletic program.
I love it, and
yes,
I love
yes.
that you have a vision for where you're going.
Yes.
A coach's job oftentimes is as much of building
yes.
a team as it is of getting to success with the current team. I mean,
yes.
you always have that influx of new and the older, experienced players
yes.
leaving you,
yes.
especially at a four-year institution such as yours. The good news is you get those freshmen for a good length of time.
That's true. That's true. That's true. And just part of the fulfillment is seeing their development, you know,
right.
from day one when they come in, and then by the time they graduate, you know, they're different people, you know, different players, different men in this case. So it's exciting. It's exciting.
One of the last things I want to leave with on this discussion is, where did you come from prior to Bristol? Because your accent does not scream Bristol.
That's true. That's true. I was born and raised in Uganda.
Oh, okay. Excellent.
In Uganda, and I moved to the United States about 14 years ago. I came to the States for on a soccer scholarship.
Excellent.
I played 4 years at Virginia Intermount College, and after graduation, I played professionally for 4 years. And then after my professional career in 2008, I moved into coaching.
Excellent.
So, yes.
Which I know a lot of people end up doing, because your passion for the game still remains, whether you're playing or whether you're helping others to be their best.
That's true. Sometimes you want to jump on the field and...
Let me just go do it for you.
Yeah,
Coach,
yeah.
It's such a pleasure. We wish you the very best in the last couple of games for the season, and we hope that you'll come back and talk to us a little bit as you get into the next recruiting months and building your team again for next year.
Yeah, so thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure, sir. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
thank you, and
thank
have
you.
A great day. All right, I'm going to switch sides a little bit. Pat, Pat, come on in. Lee County Clerk Pat Chappelle. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
I'm great, but I can imagine that you are pretty busy these days.
Yes, we are, and we're very excited because people are voting early.
Good, and I actually mentioned that already on the show, and I said that you would help me out. Early voting has been going on for, 3 weeks?
Yes, it started, it actually only goes in 11 days.
Oh, 11 days. It feels like longer, I guess.
Well, you can vote in Lovington little bit longer because we have to do the processing for the mail ballots.
Okay, I gotcha. The early voting process has changed so significantly and in such a beneficial way over the last couple of years.
Oh.
One, you have early voting centers, so to speak. What are they called?
Is that They're called voting centers.
Voting centers.
Yes.
Okay, and that's a huge benefit because you don't have to go to a certain location like we did in past years.
Love it.
You just show up at one of these places and you cast your vote early.
That's right.
As long as you are a registered voter and you're on the list, you're good to go.
You're good to go. As long as you're a registered voter in Lee County.
In Lee County. Okay,
yes.
That's an important distinction because we have so many visitors, so many people who live in other places but work here right now. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you cannot vote in Lee County if you live in Idaho.
That's right.
Okay.
Or even another place in the state.
Okay.
Now, we think that is coming.
Okay.
But it's not here yet.
Okay. So we'll look for that in the next years.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little bit about what is maybe different or new that we should be aware of about this election season, or is it pretty much going as it's supposed to be and has been for the couple of years before?
Well, it is. We're new this year in the fact that we're 100% vote centers.
Wonderful.
Which means you can go to any location in the county and cast your ballot.
Wonderful.
We love that. Last election cycle, we had 3 polling places, Caprock, Maljamar, and Monument, that were not vote centers.
Okay.
But now we are 100% vote centers. We really like that. One thing changed on this election, and we want to caution people, is there is no straight party ticket.
Okay, so you can't just circle the bubble Republican and expect that to go and work for you.
That's right,
Lindsay.
You
actually have to take the time to choose each individual one.
You choose each race you want.
Okay.
And then we also have, of course, something on the backside.
Right.
We have the constitutional amendments and the bond questions. So we're please asking people to make sure that they vote that backside also.
I heard you say this, and it's funny because we keep mentioning on the program, Dr. McCleary is really big at telling us to start, do the bonds first so that you don't get tired. And I heard you on a interview the other day that you did, and you said, maybe you just need to start on the back and move forward. And really the point here is that there are just as many important issues that have to be decided by the people on the back. And it is a rather lengthy ballot this year.
Yes, it is.
Right?
Yes, it is. It's not as long as some other counties in our state,
I believe that.
But it is a lengthy ballot. And we have some ballot retention, judge retention questions on the backside, too.
Okay.
So we want to tell people to be sure and look on that backside.
Another thing I want to talk about is there are several contested races, and we're talking with those this morning.
Yes.
There's also several folks here who are uncontested races, and we'll try to get them into the show as well.
Great.
What do people need to realize when they see that there's only one candidate for a particular item? Do they have to vote? Because I think sometimes people go, well, there's only one of them, so do I care?
Is
it important for them to go ahead and bubble in that they do want them or don't want them?
Yes. Yes, it is, because it shows support.
Okay.
If they vote, It shows support for that candidate,
okay,
and that's always good.
That is a good thing.
Yes.
It just helps the system look more fulfilled. Okay.
And we have one write-in.
Okay.
And that's another thing to mention, and that's in the U.S. Representative race.
Okay.
And
what is a write-in candidate? What does that mean, just for those of us who aren't as savvy?
Okay. On a write-in candidate, you have to do 2 things. You have to put in the little bubble that says write-in, because there won't be a name on that.
I see.
Then you have to write the write-in name
in. So you have to actually know that you want to put that name in, because you have to come with the name yourself.
Yes. And we will have at the polling place the correct spelling of the write-in, okay. In case okay. anyone wonders.
Okay, perfect. So you're going to help mm-hmm. us out, as you always
yes.
do.
Thank
How many
you.
Voting centers will we have for this election?
We have 16 countywide.
Oh, my goodness. If you can't
Isn't
find a place to be, then, you
That's
know.
That's right.
You mentioned, like, Caprock, Maljamar. So if I was going to be out in the oil field that day, and
yes.
maybe I was afraid I wasn't going to make it back in time, if you're mm-hmm. remotely close to any of those, you can even go and
you
hit those
You can vote
up.
There.
Okay.
Yes.
Fantastic.
And it is great. We love it. We had several people try to vote at Monument.
Okay.
Last year.
But they couldn't because
they
it was
couldn't.
Not at that time open center.
Yes,
but
it is now. So
you've been working
please,
hard.
Yes.
Pat Chappelle, Lee County Clerk, thank you so
thank
very
you.
Much for being
thank
here.
You,
Thanks
Lindsay.
For helping to educate us. And last comments
it.
To the voters?
Oh, be sure and vote 7-7 on Election Day if you haven't voted early. If you'd like to vote early, early voting will end at 6 p.m. this Saturday.
Okay.
So you also
That's the
have
last
Saturday.
Day for early voting.
Yes.
Okay. I've been lying to
thank
them a little
you.
Bit, but I knew you'd set
That's
me
okay.
straight. Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Thanks, Lindsay. Appreciate you.
Hey, BJ, how about you? You want to come talk to me, sir? We are going to talk about one of those contested races that I did mention, and this is for a county commission seat. Reverend BJ Choice, good morning. How are you?
How you doing today?
I'm just
How you
fabulous.
Doing? How you doing?
We're so glad you're here, and I appreciate you taking the time. Tell everybody about what race it is that you are going to be participating in this Tuesday, and what why this is important for you to run for this.
Well, I am competing in District 4.
District 4, okay.
Yeah, County Commissioner District 4.
Okay.
And it's so important to me that I have an opportunity to serve the people. I'm a people person.
You are a people person.
I love serving the folk.
Tell me what it is that you've been doing in your career or in your spare time, should we say, that has been getting you prepared for what you believe is the seat.
Well, I have been pastoring for over 50 years. And I have continued to serve the public at large. I enjoy people. Everybody's important, from the least to the greatest. And it's part of my life.
Part of your life. And so this opportunity is obviously a big role. There's only a few commissioners. I say, there's five or six commissioners?
Five.
And they are making decisions as elected officials for the county as a whole. What is it that makes this so appealing to you about this kind of responsibility?
Well, you have an opportunity to impact people's lives as a county commissioner and with roads, and making sure that the budget is mm-hmm. is right and being fiscally responsible. You have an opportunity to impact people's lives for their health and welfare.
Right.
That's part of what they do, really, is Absolutely. Being responsible for the health and welfare of the people and their moral good and their general welfare.
General welfare.
Yes.
And what is this race? I know all of these races are always, they're tiring. I would imagine they're exhausting. I don't know that I could ever do it. So I have a lot of respect for you. But this is something that you have actually had in your sights for some time, and now it's finally upon you. What is it that you'd like to say to the voters about why you would be the best candidate?
Well, first of all, I did run 2 years ago,
okay.
and I lost, and I am running again. And it's important that they have representation from all facets of the community. And I represent qualified diversity, that I lend a voice to the county commissioner, reflecting on the total citizenry. And I really would appreciate their vote.
Appreciate their vote. What have you been doing in your spare time? Whenever you're not out campaigning and you're not out preaching, what else do you do that you enjoy here in the Lea County area?
I enjoy watching sports.
Ah, me too.
I enjoy watching sports.
Did you watch the World Series last night?
I missed that series.
Ooh, good thing that was not one of the best games of the series.
Who won?
The Royals. So we have another game tonight. The end is tonight.
Oh, yes, that's right. That's
yep,
right.
Now it's
I
tonight.
Was thinking, I was messed up. I was thinking this was the end.
That was the, well, I thought it was going to be the end because I thought the Giants were going to win it. But we digress.
I did. That's not good for me to say this. I may lose some votes. But I'm not a Redskins fan or a Cowboy fan, but I'm a Colt McCoy.
Colt McCoy fan. And I tell you what, that was an amazing game on Monday night.
Yes.
So I think everybody came out a winner. I don't think Cowboys fans agree with me.
No.
I think that was a fabulous game. Well, in your spare time of enjoying sports and preaching to the people and serving, we wish you the very best of luck on Tuesday as you are in the race for District four.
Four. District four.
County commission seat.
County commission seat, district four.
BJ Choice.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate you. Thanks so much. And now let's get in the other half of that competition. Mr. Jim Britton, if he could come this way. I'm summoning him from afar. I'm going to keep saying it. I'm going to say it until you turn blue in the face. Oh, till I turn blue in the face. Tuesday, November 4th is election day. If you have not already early voted, which as the county clerk just explained to you, you have until Saturday evening at 6 o'clock, she said, to do your early voting. Any of the centers that are currently open, come on in. Let's get you on the camera, sir. We just talked about District 4 for the county commission seat, and here's the other half of that race. Mr. Jim Britton, good morning, sir. How are you?
Good morning, Lindsay. I'm fantastic.
Excellent. Well, we welcome you back to the show. You actually, you and BJ both have been on the campaign trail for quite some time. I know that this is something that you talk a little bit about your current position being held as the county commissioner and how this process has still been something new for you in spite of that.
Well, as I said before, I was appointed the 1st of May by Governor Susana Martinez to the Lea County Commission. I have been serving now for 4 months and really enjoyed that service. And now it's time to be reelected. So a week from yesterday, November 4th, is the election. And I'm very confident and very hopeful that I'll be reelected and then serve for another 4 years.
Talk to me a little bit about your experience prior to being appointed. What have you been doing and what of the experience that you have in your career and in life will make you what you believe to be the best option for this commission seat?
Lindsay, I've lived in Hobbs since 1951. Graduated from Hobbs High School in 1965, went to New Mexico State. Got a degree in chemistry, came back to Hobbs and worked for what everyone knows as Unichem International for 42 years. I was president of that organization, 300 employees. So my business background is the strength that I have to serve the commission.
And what about being a commissioner appeals to you the most? What are the responsibilities that you find you would be most helpful in?
I guess the part I'm enjoying the most is learning all of the activities that are going on in Lea County.
There's a lot going on, huh?
There's a whole lot going on. The part that interests me most is the finance part. I truly believe that any organization, whether it be your personal finances, whether it be a church, civic, or business, the finances are what are important. So I focus a lot on the finances to make absolutely sure that the county is spending our money in the most appropriate manner to get the biggest bang for the buck.
And there's a lot of money to be spent right now because of how great of our economy has been over the last few years. There's lots of projects going on, and I foresee that that's going to be a big undertaking for the coming years.
It is, and for those of us who have been around for a while, we know that there are ups and downs in the oil patch, and right now we're on a big high, and I just want to make sure that we spend the money appropriately, but that we also maintain the rainy day fund.
There you go.
Because you never know when the rainy day is going to come.
When the rainy day is going to hit. Tell me a little bit about what you do in your spare time when you're not serving as a commissioner right now or campaigning for re-election.
The number one thing in Judy and my life right now is our two grandbabies in Los Angeles.
And they're so cute.
And we're going to go see them next week, actually, right after the election, because we haven't seen them now in about 2 months.
You've been a little busy.
That's number one.
Okay.
I'm a big exercise nut. I do a lot of running. I work out at the gym, big snow skier, civic activities, involvement in the church. So all of those things, but diet and exercise number one in my life after the grandbabies.
After the grandbabies. Last discussion, tell the voters why you think that you should be their choice when it comes time to the election process, either between now and Saturday or on Tuesday.
I believe I have the credentials. I have the business background. I now have four and a half months of experience behind me. I know Lea County. I've been a lifelong resident. I do think I'm the best candidate.
Jim Britton, thank you so very much, sir, for joining us this morning. We appreciate you being here. Good
luck.
Thank
you, Lindsay.
And that wraps up the District 4 County Commission contested race. Let's move on. I know that I saw Sandy Goad. Sandy Goad is here, and she is actually running for probate judge. This is the last, I believe, of the contested races that will be on your ballot. Good morning, Sandy. How are you?
Good morning, Lindsay. I'm great.
Very nice to see you here. Tell me a little bit about what it is that you are running for and why you believe this is a position that you'd like to hold.
Well, I'm running for probate judge of Lea County, and I believe that I would be good in this because I have been an educator forever and ever, and I feel like probate judges need to educate people. And so I feel like I've got everything that I need to do that.
Do me a favor, and just for those who are sitting there going, you know, I kind of know what that word means, but what exactly does a probate judge do? Can you kind of describe what the role consists of?
Well, a probate judge simply facilitates the will of a deceased person to dole out the properties of the person who is deceased to the heirs. And if it's uncontested, that would be my job. If it's a contested will, then it moves on to another court. So I do the easy stuff.
The easy stuff. But I say you say easy, and you're right as far as maybe a paper processing perspective, but you're dealing with people with very raw emotions. As someone who was an executor in an estate, I can tell you it was one of the worst things I ever did. And it was a process. Mine wasn't contested. It was fairly easy. But it's still a difficult time for these folks that you're going to be dealing with.
That is so true. And I also feel that I'm good in that area because I'm a people person. I love people. I love to help people. I love to do for people. And so, you know, I think I'll be able to help them through that time that's so sorrowful.
Tell me a little bit about what it is that your experience prior to this is that you mentioned educator. Tell us, paint a little picture about why this would be a good role for you to fit into.
Well, honestly, just because I am such a people person, I think that would be a good one of the good reasons. But because I am an educator, I believe that part of the strain of a death at the end is not knowing what to do.
Right.
And so I feel like if I can do some teaching about what the probate process is all about, that I'll be helpful to people and to make it a smoother finish.
What is it that you do in your spare time when you're not going to hopefully, based on your desires, be probate judge?
Oh my gosh. Well, I act, I sing, I'm president of the local community theater, which I do go off at the end of this year. I've put my 4 years in. But
I'm sure they're very disappointed.
Well, anybody want to be president?
She's also recruiting while she's running. I know that they will have big shoes to fill. If you had just a few minutes to tell the voters why Sandy Goode should be elected or be their choice for the probate judge contest coming up on either Tuesday of general election day or up into that early election, tell them why you'd like to do that.
I have lived in this community for 43 years. I love this community. I love the people. I like the weather most of the time. I feel like I'd like to give back to the community that's been so good to me. I raised my family here, and this community's been great to me, and I'd like to just give back.
Well, we appreciate it. We appreciate you being here this morning, Sandy Goode, again running for probate judge. There is a contested race in this situation. I do not believe that your competitor is here, but Tanya Toomey, and we appreciate all of the those who had contested races showing up. I believe that there was the three, and I think that y'all all were here to be represented to some degree. So thank you very much. Appreciate you very much. All right, now a couple of things that I mentioned. We have just a few more minutes. There are some folks here who do not have to work quite as hard because they are not being contested. Can I get the incoming sheriff Ackerman? Steve, can you? That was almost. I almost just called him sheriff. I don't think that the current sheriff would actually have much heartburn over that, but we're going to let him just say a few words. We're also going to visit with Representative David Gallegos in just a moment. Hello, sir. Welcome to the show. So the old sheriff, the former sheriff, I know he's still current sheriff, say that get used to this because Lindsay's going to have a microphone in your face for the next few years.
I've heard that a few times, yes.
I know he's going to be warning you if he hadn't already. You are one of those who I call the fortunate ones. You don't have a contested race. And
yes,
I say fortunate. You already had to do big battle earlier in the year. So
sure
by no means did you get to escape the competition, so to speak, of this.
No.
Now you can rest a little easy knowing that you are the only name on the ballot. Tell me a little bit about your excitement and your expectations as going into the sheriff position coming in the beginning of the year.
I'm thrilled. There's a lot of work to be done, and we've got a great, great foundation and baseline of employees in the department. Really, really looking forward to it. As you well know, the population in Lea County is through the roof. Plenty of work comes along with that population. And in addition to the prosperity, there's a lot of work to go with it. So looking forward to the responsibility.
Well, just remind people of how much experience you have to bring with you as you come in January.
I've got a long background with the county, 23 years. First 10 years of it I spent at detention. Next 13 years I've been with the Sheriff's Department, not much in the department that I haven't been responsible for or worked at for a point in time. I've taught at the Law Enforcement Academy for 10 years. Love the profession, definitely want to continue to give back to it on that side. I've managed the budget for the last six fiscal cycles, but 10.
All the important stuff.
Yes, ma'am. So not intimidated by any of those responsibilities or duties at all.
Is the correct term incoming sheriff? Is that how I'm supposed to be saying that?
Sheriff-elect.
Sheriff-elect. I knew there was something more appropriate. Ma'am. Sheriff-elect Steve Ackerman, thank you so much, sir. Such a pleasure. Congratulations to you. Thanks for being here. How about Representative David Gallegos? Would you come just for a quick second? I know. He was like, I don't even have anything. I don't have to work hard. Why are you making me talk? There you go. How are you, sir?
Doing well.
Good to see you. I just wanted to give you just a few minutes. I mentioned to the sheriff-elect that you've already done your battle, and I say that. Did you have a contested race even in the primaries?
I did not.
You didn't have to work as hard at this one,
did
you?
I'm blessed.
You worked really hard at the first time when you got
in,
though. And so I think, what would you say, because I can draw some editorial conclusions and commentary about what that maybe means, but there's a little bit of confidence, I would think, based on everyone believing that you're doing a good job and not trying to get in there and change that.
It is, and it makes you feel good because, you know, you do have different opportunities now. Last time I really had to politic, mm-hmm. but now what I'm doing is I'm going on the south side, just going door to door, and don't even have to have a palm card.
Right.
I'm taking a yellow pad and ask them, what do you need of me?
How nice.
Because that way they know I'm still out there and still willing to work.
And what is your official, what's the district or the area?
State representative for District 61. I've got the south side of Lovington, south side of Hobbs, all of Eunice, and all of Jowell, Old Center, Monument, Local Hills. That southeast corner.
Quite a bit of territory.
It is.
Maybe not high population centers and some of that, but lots of territory to be covered and lots of people who still need your help to make things happen for them at the state level.
Yes, ma'am.
Excellent. Well, it is such a pleasure to have you here. Congratulations again, and we look forward to having you in this seat for another, is it
two
already?
2 years.
2 years? I was like, I don't know how many years it's been, but time flies when you're having fun, sir. Thank you so very
much.
Appreciate it. All right. Am I missing anybody? Let's see here. I bet Josie will help me. What have we got?
Larry Scott.
Larry Scott. All right. And what position is that? Excellent. So, Mr. Scott, can you come see me for just a minute? Just this minute? Oh, and Commissioner Black is still here. That's another good one. All right. Mr. Larry Scott, good morning. Welcome to the program. We appreciate you being here.
Well, tickled to be here.
And tell me about what you are, another one of those names that I believe is gets an easier job. Is that right?
I am.
Easy job is, and you don't have to, you're not battling. Are you doing
you're
battle?
You're referring to me not having an opponent
I
in
am.
The re-election
that is
campaign.
Correct.
Yes.
That is correct.
I'm running unopposed. I was in both the primary and in
okay.
the general
so,
election.
Okay, and you like Representative so, Gallegos.
All I will be required to have is one vote, and I'm still working on my
You're
wife.
Still going to see if you can come up with that one. Well, tell me a little bit about the position that you currently in this position as well, right?
I am not.
Not,
I am
okay.
taking the position of Representative Don Bratton.
Oh, excellent. Okay, and I apologize for not remembering that.
He was, is still, House Minority Leader.
Okay.
Has served in the House for 14 years, and I have incredibly big shoes to fill.
You do, and I actually think that there was quite a bit of surprise when we found out that Bratton was not going to run again. I remember feeling that kind of a shock and a little bit of a wake in the system, because he has been such a important figure for those of us here in Southeast New Mexico and all of the work that he's done with the state. You talk about the big shoes, but it sounds to me like being uncontested, there's a lot of confidence in you.
Well, the local community came to me because Don is ex-oil and gas, had a tremendous knowledge of the oil and gas industry, and was one of very few people in Santa Fe with that knowledge.
I see.
I am also oil and gas oriented, and I think the folks in the local community wanted to have someone serving up there that could bring some oil and gas expertise to the Roundhouse because it's such an important part of the state budget.
And I normally don't do this, but man, do we need oil and gas representatives in the roundhouse. We need to make sure that Santa Fe remembers what we're doing, right?
Absolutely.
And make sure that they have accurate and very consistent information about what it is we're doing as well.
Absolutely.
Well, we appreciate you. We appreciate you being here, and I'm sorry that I kind of butchered all of that. I should have done a little bit more homework on what your role was and how excited we are that you will be taking over that seat from Don Bratton.
Looking forward to the challenge.
Thank you, sir.
Thank
we appreciate you, very you being much. Here. And last but not least, Commissioner Black. If I could get you to just for a minute. Everybody's like, really? I don't even have. I just want to let you say a few quick words, Commissioner, about you are yet again another one of those unopposed seats. You are going to be handling your job and continue to do it for another couple of years. Are you excited about continuing on where you've been for how many years already?
I've had 4 years down and 4 years to go.
4 years down, four to go. And we are excited. And were you surprised that there was no contested race for you this year?
You know, I was kind of hoping for that, because last time I had a very competitive race with Jonathan Senna and mm-hmm. Scotty Holliman in the Republican primary. My district is a very Republican district, so I really wasn't expecting an opponent in the general election, but I thought I might have an opponent in the primary election, but I didn't, and that made it a lot easier.
I was going to say, you probably worked really hard that first time, so this time you were probably grateful for a little bit of a reprieve from all the effort.
You know, after the election last time, Don Bratton said, well, you probably assured yourself of not having an opponent next time. And thank goodness he was right.
Nobody wanted to go through all that with you. Well, I say this, we know that even though the contest wasn't as hard for you this time, you're still putting in a lot of work as being a commissioner for the Lea County Commission, and we appreciate what you're doing. And anything that you'd like to say to the voters, because you're kind of going to wrap it up as far as them getting out and voting?
You know, I hope everybody will turn out and vote, and I will put in a plug for Bond Issue C.
Ah, very nice.
Bond Issue C is the for higher education bond issue, and it will definitely impact Lea County, because New Mexico Junior College is down for $5 million, and that money will be applied as part of the junior college share of the new Health and Wellness Learning Center, which is going to be a fabulous thing for all of Lea County.
A great plug, sir, and we appreciate you doing that. And as well, I'll remind you, it's on the back of the ballot, right? It's at the end.
That's right. Don't quit. Don't quit voting until you get
right.
to the end.
Don't quit. And as the county clerk said, maybe start in the back and move your way forward so that you make sure you don't get too tired. I think Dr. McCleary tells us not to get tired.
Be like a Democrat. Vote early and vote often.
You can say that. Thank you so much. Commissioner Ron Black, thank you. And Captain Walker. Oh, well, AJ, did you want to talk real quick? Okay, we're good. Rotary is every Thursday. That means tomorrow at noon you can go out to the Hobbs Country Club and you can go and visit and join Rotary. You can see what it's all about, have a great meal out at the club, and visit with a lot of great people. All right, Captain. We've taken up a lot of time today, so I am going to tell Dr. Daryl Beecham that the Western Heritage Museum and the Lea County Cowboy Hall of Fame on the campus of New Mexico Junior College would love to have you go out there. All you got to do is say, you heard it right here on the round table with Lindsay Chism, and he'll let you in for free. He got his plug anyways. Captain Walker, a really cool show. Lots of people showed up to talk about the election process, and we appreciate you and the police department, as usual, hosting us.
Right. Now, I'm so glad everyone came out. We encourage everyone. Next Wednesday, we'll be here again.
So absolutely. 7 to 9, you can come have coffee and donuts. Be on the air from 8 to about 8:45.
Great.
Thank you very much, sir. We appreciate you. That does it for today. I'm Lindsay Chism. This is Coffee with the Cops, the community coffee brought to you by New Mexico Junior College and the City of Hobbs. Have a great day, Lea County.